This is from Astron, and this is Hanno Holtis.
Okay, thank you. Hope you can hear me. My name is Hanno Holtis. I work at Astron, which is the Dutch organization for radio astronomy. And I guess I'm honored to be the first speaker here for the users, representing the users, as we are actually a very new group interested in working with IROTS. And I'm going to say a couple of words about the Appertief Long-Term Archive, so there'll be more explained later on. I actually have to thank some members of my team. The team members are not on the slide. Oh dear. I think this will go wrong. Yeah, that's better. So now the team members are on the slide. There are five members in the Altair development team at the moment. All have been working on the project, so there's contributions for all of them, but in particular, Erwin and Gijs have been preparing much of the material while I was on vacation in the past 2 weeks. So thanks to them. Just a short overview. I'll introduce you a little bit to radio astronomy and Appertief system. Then I'll go a little bit further into our project, which is called ALTA, the Appertief Long-Term Archive. I'll have a couple of slides on where we stand with IROTS, what we've been doing, where we are working on. And I'll finish with a short summary. So I'll start with a slide on astronomy in general. I think this is something that most of you will be familiar with. This is the optical domain, if you like. If you look up on a clear night, you'll see a lot of stars, or what appear to be stars. They're very much like our sun, and all stars, most stars, are organized in galaxies. Ours is the Milky Way galaxy, so the middle picture is a representation of what it looks like. We cannot see it from that point, of course. And actually, there's not one galaxy, there are many and many galaxies. And actually, there's more structure, so galaxies are clustered themselves as well. This is what most of you will be familiar with, but the optical domain, the visible light domain, it's certainly not the only domain where you can study astronomy. You can study astronomy across the whole domain of electromagnetic wavelengths. You can go to very short wavelengths, high energy, and there you'll see high energetic objects burst, black holes, etc. In the ultraviolet, you'll see new stars forming. Visible, we've just seen, but if you go to the lower, the longer frequencies, the longer wavelengths, to the lower frequencies, you'll actually start seeing completely different things. There you'll see emissions from gases. And we're looking at the radio domain. So that's on the left side picture. It's actually an image generated by the Westerbork telescope here in the Netherlands. And there you can in particular see, for example, neutral hydrogen gas, which forms actually most of the matter in the universe is neutral hydrogen gas. You will not see that the cold gas with visible optical telescopes, but you will see it with the radio in the radio domain. But we have some additional challenges. We cannot just put up a photograph and make a picture of the sky and be ready. In principle, what we do is we measure the radio waves with antennae. We do that with radio telescopes. In the Netherlands, we have since 1970 the Westerbork Synthesis Radio Telescope. It consists of 14 dishes, and it's an east-west array, so all the dishes are on a single line. Each dish has a diameter of 25 meters, and it's been in operation for a while, but it's still one of the better radio telescopes in the world, and we're currently upgrading it. That picture was a bit mangled in the conversion. But I'll say a couple of words on synthesis, radio synthesis telescopes. So each antenna is basically a simple radio antenna. But you cannot see any spatial structure from any single receiver. So what we do to be able to image a part of the sky in the radio domain, we make combinations of radio telescopes. And basically each combination of radio telescopes, which we call a baseline, if you take the signals from those, you correlate them, you get something like a Fourier component of the image of the sky. Now, Westerbork being a single-line telescope, we can at any given instance only see spatial structure in one direction. So what we actually do is we use the rotation of the Earth, and in 12 hours' time, we'll actually have scanned the full 2D image of the sky in the radio domain. Now, the way we collect the data means that we have to digitize raw radio signals at 100 megahertz level continuously and store those data for each combination of telescopes. So we're producing much data. We are producing volumes of astronomical proportions, as mentioned here. Radio telescopes have been around for a while. And there are different forms, actually. So this is a slide on another telescope that ASTRON is operating on behalf of the International LOFO Telescope Consortium. That has stations. It's a different type. So it doesn't have the dishes with receivers in them. It has static antennae put on the ground plane in fields. And those fields are spread all over Europe. We have 50 of them at the moment. We're commissioning a station, new station in Ireland. And they're all connected, and they send their signal to one place, which is the Groningen University, where we have our central processing domain. This is an instrument that has been in operation since roughly 2012. And just to give you a feeling for the amount of data that we're generating, LOFAR since 2012 has generated roughly 30 petabytes of data. This is a challenge for us to handle, to collect, to store. It's certainly also a challenge for the scientists, the astronomers, to process and deal with that. And only since a year or two, the processing actually is starting to reach the levels at which we are producing the data. So there's a lot of cold data actually in our archive for LOFAR. But the main project that the radio astronomy community is focusing on at the moment is a new instrument, which is called the Square Kilometer Array. It's the production of it will start in 2018. We expect early science 2021, roughly. And that will actually take data collection for radio astronomy in the exascale, exabytes of data generated. Look for the link, and there's a lot of information on that link about the SKA, the Square Kilometer Array. But back to Aperitif, which is our project, which is our current instrument. It's an upgrade of an already existing telescope, and it's transforming the telescope from a 14-dish telescope with single antennae, a single receiver in each dish, to a focal plane array in each dish. And basically, the single feed that we had in each dish is now being replaced by a matrix of 121 detectors, and those we can use to form different beams, look at different directions within each dish. Basically, it allows us to scan at any given time instead of one beam, which due to the dimensions of the dish, is roughly the size of the moon. We can, with Aperitif, now scan an area which is up to 40 times larger. That also means that our data rates are going up by at least 40 times, and actually the sensitivity comes in there as well. The Aperitif project has been running for a while, and we actually have been generating our first images with Aperitif. So this is the first result from Aperitif. On the left-hand side, you see an image generated with an observation using the Aperitif instrument. In the left corner, low corner, you see the size of the old WSRT image field. In this time, for Aperitif, it's much larger. It's for an object called NGC 315. On the right-hand side, you see an image in the optical domain of the same object. And it's an object that's generating large jets of gas streaming out of the central object. And those are visible in the radio domain. So where in the optical domain you see a single spot with a lot of light, in the radio domain, if you look well, maybe a bit difficult from the room, you see that there are jets. It's an elongated structure. And that's gas being ejected from the central object. Now, this is the type of work where Aperitif will be very good at. This image actually also has been published on our site, so I'm plugging our ASTRON site here at the moment. If you go to www.aston.nl, daily image, or you follow the link from the main page, there we'll be publishing new results from Aperitif and all our other projects continuously. So if you're interested in radio astronomy, what we do, go there and follow the image. So for Aperitif, a lot more data is being generated. Also, the characteristics of the instruments are changed, where in the past, Westerbork, like we do for LOFAR, is mainly targeted observations requested by scientists. Aperitif is now being transformed into a survey instrument. That's what it's good for. It can scan large pieces of the sky. And that means that our operation will change somewhat. We decided to build a new archive for that, called ALTA. And the archive as such is very generic. It's very similar, I guess, to most archives. So our main use cases are we need to be able to ingest data from the instrument and from the processing sites, store the data in long-term storage, and we need to allow our users to query on the metadata associated with the data products and retrieve the data if they want to. And of course, we need some monitoring and control. But since it's a survey instrument, we'll actually have to support a workflow, which is a continuous workflow with regular and standardized steps. The observation stage already, Aperitif will be operating a limited number of standard configurations where we'll scan all of the sky. The data from the instrument will be put into the archive, and from there it's taken. ALTA will not support the data analysis itself within the scope of ALTA, but it does need to support the whole data flow to get the data from the instrument to the processing clusters, to the survey teams that are working on that, and actually also retrieve their results again, and that in several levels of data processing. So we have identified a number of levels of data processing from the instrument, raw data, time series data, basically. Initial processing will basically do quality analysis and calibration of the data. And then the real science projects are being generated in the next levels. Images are being created, and tables of sources that are extracted from those images will be created. So typical numbers for the archive are up there. So we expect to be generating for Aperitif roughly 4 petabytes each year, with an estimated duration of the survey of 5 years. The target volume, total volume, is 20 petabytes. Those will be in typical data product size of 1 to 60 gigabytes, tens to hundreds of millions of data products. The typical data rates that we need to support in this data flow is 10 to 20 gigabit per second sustained. And the number of users is not that large, I guess. So we expect that there will be hundreds of users, initially actually more like tens of users actively working with the archive. But if we have, as soon as we get releases to the public domain, we also will be need to support requests from thousands of more anonymous users who are going to query on our archive and retrieve the data. Also, not unique, but still, data models are of importance to us, and in particular, provenance is of importance to us. So we have data that is being generated in several stages, and we need to be, if a data product, an end data product is being collected, it needs to be traceable through the whole processing chain back to the original observation. So there's a lot of provenance information that we need to collect and store with the data, basically. We actually chose to, not chose, we had a requirement, I should say. We need to be conformant to some level with Virtual Observatory. I will not go into that detail, but astronomy actually has been relatively well organized in terms of data products, data formats, and exposing data to the wide world. In our case, there's a project called the Virtual Observatory, which has developed standards and tools to publish data and find your data for astronomers. We are trying to be compliant with that, and they have based their the provenance part of the data model on the W3C provenance model. I won't go into the detail, but the relations between data products are essential to us, and there's a lot of metadata in there. High-level system overview, also not very different from what you would expect from another archive. We'll have a central bulk storage system. There's a database connected to that. Actually, in our case, it will serve both the IROTS ICAT server database, as well as store the additional data model, which we'll put in a separate database. And we expose our archive through a web server to the public domain
where people need to query on data and look at quick results and searching in catalogs. At the bottom part is a data transfer node. We need actually also to support high throughput data connections to outside our own domain. So we're looking for a system where we can bypass a real full firewall, and we're looking into something like a science DMZ setup for that. When he mentioned the data analyst processing itself is not in scope for the Alta system. So another diagram, another view, if you like, on the data flows. We need to support all these processing data flows. We have, at the moment, a collaboration with Surfsara in Amsterdam, and doing a pilot project with them to see if we can set up a distributed, geographically distributed data storage system. We're looking at the different types of integration that we can do using IROTS, both in Amsterdam for Surfsara and Dwingelo for Astron. So that's currently being investigated. And all the processing flows are in there. I think I should not spend too much time on that for now. Something that we did quite a lot of work on in the initial part of the project is set up our build and test environment. We have chosen to use Ansible. I think that's used by the IROTS developers as well. But we're using Ansible for our deployment for a number of reasons, but it helps us in setting up a, always being able to set up a clean environment and know that the configuration is as we need. We have a development test acceptance production suite where we actually have a build step in between to generate artifacts that we're going to distribute. The develop, build, test part of that is all done in VMs. Actually, we're using Vagrant as a VM configuration and management tool. And basically, it helps us to set up a complete Alta environment if you check out the code with a single command. And you'll have a fully functional Alta environment, which is very useful to get new people up to speed and to build a new environment. Acceptance and production are done on dedicated servers. If you're interested in our setup, then ask us in the break, in a break, where we can try and demo or tell you more. So now for IROTS, in the initial stage of the project, we were looking for data management layers. And we compared a number of projects, products. The conclusion that we had for IROTS is that basically when at first glance already, it seemed to be supporting many of our requirements. So it's it helps in abstracting storage resources. It helps us to exchange or change our storage environment. Also actually in geographically distributed environments, so we can move data around or add a new location to the total storage environment. We don't have to do a lot of programming, so you can do your data management policy based. And it seems to be, it was advertised to be very efficient in data transfers and proven at scale. What we also like is the very active developing user communities and actually used, and IROTS was already used and known by many of our partners. Also another thing that stood out from the other tools that we looked at is the level of documentation and maturity that it had. Some concerns that we had at the time is that there is a single ICAT for each zone, which is something like a single point of failure. And the metadata, although it looks very promising, I think it's not going to perform at the level where we need to build our complex data model. We did some experimentation with object stores as a nearline facility for storing large volumes of data in Dwingelo. We were a bit surprised, I guess, where that we found that the object store itself cannot directly be used to get your data from using IROTS tools. You also have to use always have to use compound resource with a POSIX-based cache in front of that. There are some additional challenges in being able to scale that then out that will actually require additional components like a load balancer and a distributed file system below that. We think we need sufficient capacity there. Data volumes and are going to be a challenge for us in any case. In our experience, all data buffers will run full at some point. And we need to be able to manage that. We're still looking at that, how to best set it up. And we're actually also talking to the guys from Renzi about best practices there. The real implementation part on IROTS. We started implementing our ingest part. I think it's also in principle rather similar to what you'll find in other archives. But we have this additional challenge, I think two challenges that may be somewhat non-standard. One is that we want to be able to manage our data capacity and allocations. So we want to, before data is being sent to our archive, we want to make sure that there is space to receive it. Our landing zone is part of the archive, but actually first you have to get an allocation in the landing zone before you get the data. Another maybe non-standard part is that our clients need to be able to monitor the whole process. So although we are implementing all the functionality within IROTS using rules, we will have a message bus communicating the progress of the whole ingest to the client. Which brings me to the last slide. For us, we're still new. It's still early times, I guess. We're not having a production system yet. But IROTS does seem to be very promising. It seems to be ticking many of the boxes that we need, although there's some parts where we have to do some work, obviously. But also, there's a lot of help in that area available. There's a vibrant developer and user community, as we found yesterday and today as well. We are developing with a 10 or more years horizon for our archives. We still are hosting 1970 data from the Westerbork telescope. I'm not saying that we're going to port that to IROTS right away, but if we make a new archive, we want to be able to sustain it for very long times because astronomical data is very static. There's slow progression there, slow changes there, and people actually have an interest in looking at very old data. We are very interested in the new capabilities. So I already mentioned the object store. I think possibly the multi-part development going on can help us in relaxing requirements on the cache in front of that, if you can directly access the object store. We're also very interested in the query arrow development. We need an integrated, separate metadata database from the ICAT. And actually, for our community, it's very interesting and relevant to have a fully mature, feature-complete Python client and server support. So we're also very happy with the recent releases there and looking forward to the new developments. For our side, Alta is planned to go live this year, before the end of the year. Surveys commissioning is still going on, and surveys production will start in 2018, and we expect roughly a first release around 2019. Please keep an eye on the Aston website and see the results as they come in. Thank you.